What I've done here is I've redrawn the picture that captured the contours, and notice that it's relatively elongated like this. Now, the problem with the method of steepest descent is that, yes, the gradient takes you in the direction where you decrease the function the fastest. And what that means is that in this direction, you have this parabola, and then you find the minimum in that direction. Now, it may seem like in the next iteration, you would then directly home in on the solution, at least if this is a problem in two variables. But what actually happens is that the method of steepest descent starts bouncing back and forth like that and takes a very long time to actually get to the minimum. Now, the reason why a method of steepest descent starts bouncing back and forth like this is because of these elongated contours. And the elongated contours happen when the matrix with which we're computing has a very large condition number. In other words, you know, we've sort of seen this before. The major axis divided by the minor axis is large when the condition number is large. Same thing here. So you can say, well, maybe that's just a problem we can't resolve. Or you can say, well, if only our matrix had nice circular contours, then what? Well, then we would have our solution here and we'd have nice circles around it. And if you think about it, if you have a paraboloid that has nice circular contours, then the direction in which you decrease fastest actually points directly at the center of the paraboloid. And therefore, we would actually expect to converge in one iteration. Okay. Now, we can say, well, we have a nice method for the case where A is the identity, because obviously the identity has nice circular contours, and so does any constant times the identity, but that's not very interesting. What instead we want to do is say, well, isn't there some way of transforming A, or AX equals B, into something that has a matrix that has much nicer properties? Well, a first step towards that would be to say, well, we're trying to solve AX equals B, and if we multiply both sides by M inverse, now obviously we don't want to actually multiply by M inverse, we want to solve with M in a strategic point of the algorithm, but let's not go there. Anyway, if we then do this, then if M resembles A, then M inverse times A starts resembling the identity, and you end up with something with nice round contours. So we could say, replace our matrix A by M inverse times A in this entire calculation, and replace the right-hand side by M inverse times B, and then lo and behold, when we're done, we will have computed the exact same solution X and everything is fine. All right, well, there turn out to be elegant ways of doing this. As a matter of fact, it's a matter of replacing your search direction by M inverse times the residual, and you have the same net effect where in the end you end up with the vector X that you want. However, there remains a problem, and that is this matrix may not be symmetric positive definite, and all of the discussion we've had so far is for symmetric positive definite matrices. So then either we need to generalize our theory to matrices that are not symmetric positive definite, or we need to fix this. How can we fix this? Well, merely picking M to be symmetric positive definite would make it resemble A more, but the product of two symmetric positive definite matrices is not necessarily symmetric positive definite, so that's not good enough. But what we can do is we can find a symmetric positive definite matrix that is approximately equal to A. We can then compute its Kolesky factors. So we can say M is equal to L times L transpose. Let's put a little M at the bottom here. Notice that that would be approximately equal to the Kolesky factorization of A. And notice what that means is that if we look at L inverse times L inverse transpose, A is L times L transpose. So this right here is then approximately equal to the identity. Now, if we start with AX equals B, let's give ourselves a little bit of room. Notice that we can multiply both sides by LM inverse. And then we can plop in the identity here by putting in this right here. And then we have a new matrix with which we iterate right there. We have a transformed vector X with which we iterate, and we have a transformed right-hand side B with which we iterate. If we call this Y and we call this B tilde, and we call this here B, then we would end up with a symmetric positive definite matrix B times Y is equal to B tilde, where we're trying to compute Y. We can apply this method but to this problem, and then in the end we can back a transform. Now it turns out we don't even need to do that. It turns out that if you just cleverly compute your search direction in the right way, then the net effect is the equivalent of everything that I just said. This kind of transformation of matrix A, the matrix that makes that happen, the matrix M, is referred to as a preconditioner. And notice that the basic techniques here are very similar to what we saw when we took our matrix A and split it into M minus N. There too, we said we would like for M to resemble A. So it actually turns out that some of the splitting matrices that work well for splitting methods also can be employed as preconditioners for these kinds of descent methods.